this talk, which is Web Accessibility Made Easy for WordPress. I promise it's easy. This talk outline, I'm going to give you some facts and an explanation of Section 508, WCAG. I'm going to offer our 11 easy steps to help become compliant, and then I'm going to give you some free developer tools. But then after that, I'm going to actually dive into a second talk that I have, and it's how to audit your website for accessibility, at least basically. All right, a few facts. Over 1 billion people worldwide have some sort of disability. I believe it's like 1.3. That's a lot of people. And of that, an estimated 253 million people worldwide live with a vision impairment. And 19 million of that are children. And I have two daughters, 18 and 15, and they're just intertwined with technology. They're just like the board. It's one and the same. They have been assimilated. And a cool point that I learned, actually, Matt Mullenweg told me this, was that everybody will be disabled at some point in your life. We are born not able to read, talk, see, and when we get towards the latter years, most of us are going to go colorblind and have some other issues. And in the short term, we're talking broken arm, is something as simple as you can have a bag of groceries or your child in one hand and you're trying to do something with the other hand. So every single one of us will be in this type of situation where this will help us. All right, there were 814 Section 508 lawsuits in 2017, and then last year there was over 2,200. All these lawsuits were filed in 2018 were filed by less than 28 plaintiffs. I believe it was about 28 or 30, but I just put under 50 to make sure the facts are right. And the majority of those lawsuits were filed under the Title III of the ADA Act, which pretty much if anybody here, you know, you have blue handicapped parking spaces, we have the ramps going in the doors, you gotta have accessibility in bathrooms, that's ADA Title III saying that every individual has to have the same access to everything that everybody else has. And that's where a lot of the lawsuits are happening, because they're saying that individuals don't have full access to your website or software. All right, here's a little graph. This is the last 4 years of accessibility lawsuits. And keep in mind, these are only federal lawsuits. I was just in California a couple months ago for WordCamp Orange County, and I met a few developers there, and they were letting me know that they had almost 4,000 lawsuits at the state level last year. That's just state level. And in California, they're suing developers now for not developing websites that are compliant. That's a big deal. You see here, 2015, we got about 57, and then 262, 814, 2200. I'm gonna have to redo this graph here soon. The majority of the lawsuits are in Florida, New York, and California. New York is by far the 2200. I think New York had about 1500. Florida had about 500, and the other 200 or so were split up between all the other states. So you can see where it's happening. Alright, what is WCAG 2.1? Okay, WCAG 2.1 is the Web Content Accessibility Guideline. This is basically the worldwide guidelines that they put together by the W3C. I believe they have three different levels, A, AA, AAA. Section 508 says you have to only be A and AA compliant for WCAG. And they hit on all the main categories for disability. Alright, Section 508. Section 508, pretty much just a dumbed-down version of WCAG. WCAG is the worldwide guideline. Section 508 is the American law. This says all government agencies, anybody doing business with the government, even nonprofit organizations that don't get money from the government, you have to be Section 508 compliant. It is the law. And in most cases, you actually have to sign a piece of paper saying your website is Section 508 compliant to even be able to bid on a government contract or even to begin the process of getting funded. It was signed into law, I believe, December of 2018, and I give a link to it later on in this talk that you can actually go see the actual law. deals with text alternatives, media, make sure it's adaptable to all phones, like mobile, tablets, operable. This deals with keyboard accessibility, things like time limits, seizures. You want to make sure you can navigate your website without using a mouse. That's very important. Understandable. Make sure it's readable. Make sure it's laid out in a predictable manner. Make sure it's other input assistance understand what you're doing. Robust. Make sure it's compatible with lots of assistive technologies. There's a lot out there, and there's a lot that's just coming out at a fast pace. So make sure, you know, think about it, not just in the here and now, think about it a few years down the road as well. All right, why does Section 508 exist? This is why. No matter. I'm sure, how many people here are developers? How many are designers? All right, so we've all gotten to that fight with our client about that one font that you just can't find, or this one color that they've got to have. That is just like, man, this right here is what a blind person sees when they go to your website. Nothing. It's all irrelevant. So what we've done is we've come up with our 11 easy steps to help you become compliant. Now, I want to say this. You can follow every word on this 11-step process, and you still got a good chance you are not fully compliant. It really depends on your site. You have a lot of stuff. If you have a small site, this will cover just about everything. But accessibility is a very broad subject, and I could be here all weekend for WordCamp, and I still wouldn't be able to tell you guys everything I want to tell you. Alright, so we're just going to go through all these steps one by one, so don't worry. Okay, number one, provide alternative text for non-text content. This one sets the little hair I have on fire when I don't see this. It's so easy. Okay, I'm sure everybody knows where we are here. We're in your media library. You're back into your site. You upload a picture. First thing it does is it sends you to something like this. Now this was at the NFB. This is, I don't know if you can see this, see with your tongue. This is a device that you put on and lets you see with your tongue. That's a real device. So, I know, that's pretty cool. So when you upload your picture, you're going to come over here to your alt text, and you're going to add some text. Here's a close-up. And I'm just describing the picture, a picture of a device that allows you to see using your tongue, something like that. They say you want under 200 characters. I try to say give them a couple of good descriptive sentences, but this is very, very important. One of the most common things I see. And then Gutenberg, with the Gutenberg update, what this does is when you add a picture, this allows you to come down here and label it decorative. Now your picture has to either be labeled decorative or have an alt text, one of the two. If it's labeled decorative, what that does, it tells your screen reader, basically, your assistive technology, that's useless information, skip right over it. So it doesn't even tell the user that that's there. All right, number two, label your form elements for your input fields. Oh, super, super easy one. Simple as this, label your form elements. Last name, first name. Now with pretty much all, you know, contact form 7, whatever you use, pretty much they all come out where you can start it and it just automatically labels your form elements. But like contact form 7, if you're adding new ones, it won't automatically do it for you. I might have fixed it in the last couple months. It's been a little bit since I checked that. But that's why I add this slide, to just show you how to add your own labels. Alright, add manuscript or closed captions for videos. Add your audio description for animations. What does that say? Well, this is an example right here. This is a YouTube video. How many people here use YouTube to upload videos for your site and all that stuff? Okay. So you guys understand how easy it really is to upload a video to YouTube, and I'm sure that's probably why you guys use it. It's why I use it. It's super easy. Well, another fantastic tool that YouTube does is it automatically will add closed caption and subtitles to you in multiple languages if you want. But you have to tell it to do that. Okay, an example of audio description. This right here is
It's just a short little video that some lady did explaining what this looks like. And this is the Lion King. I'm pretty sure everybody knows what the Lion King is. I don't think I'm that old. I might be. But what this is, if you go here, I just made a short little code up there. It's 2 minutes long. It just describes, as this video is playing, I'm sure everybody knows what scene this is in the beginning. Well, it's just a lady in the background describing what's happening, because for the next 2 minutes, there's no actual words describing everything that's happened. So she's just saying, you know, the lions are going to the top of the Pride Rock, and I don't even know the characters' names. But what I do know is that more than this, too, another live, real-world scenario is, like, if you're watching YouTube or you're watching Netflix, my kids always have the subtitles on the bottom. I don't know why. I mean, 18 and 15, they can hear just fine. But in there, like, you'll see the scene where someone's walking and you'll see down the subtitles crackling or chimes in the background or eerie music playing. That's more of a real-world scenario for something like this. So not only do you want subtitles for your text, but you want subtitles for your non-text, for things happening. All right, ensure your color contrast meets minimum thresholds. For all the designers that raised their hands, this is for you guys, because developers, you just give them the color and they're just gonna do it. So it's up to y'all to tell them exactly what you want. Minimum contrast ratio, you're talking 4.5 to 1. With the exception of links and text, they can be 3 to 1. This is an example of bad contrast. So this is bad. And it's not just, I think it's like 9% of men become colorblind over time. And so this really affects a lot of people. But this is more than just colorblindness, because this center one right here, if I look at it long enough, my eyes start to twitch, and it just messes with my mind. So it's more than just vision when you're dealing with bad contrast. What does good contrast look like? This is it right here. Now, this has to do with more than accessibility. If anybody here, well, I know everybody here, you're building a website, you're traveling a website, if you go to a site that has bad contrast, I mean, you're going to be there for 30 seconds, and you're out of there. We all know what that does to our Google analytics. We all know what that does to our customer base. I mean, you just lose so much with a simple thing like this. So make sure you have good contrast. All right. Make all your link text descriptive and underline them. Really, you got to have more than one way to show that that's a link. So I just hit underline them. For a bad example of link descriptions, click here and read more. How many here have used click here or read more? Okay, we've got 4 honest people, 5 honest people in the audience. 6. I've used click here so many times until I realized this was bad. Don't do it. For an example of good link description, follow this link to Wikipedia. The reason why this is because when an individual is using their screen reader, they can set it up multiple ways. One way they set up is just links, or when they're just scrolling through the site, they're just hitting headers and links. So if you get to a link that says click here, there is absolutely no context clues in there to tell the individual where they're going. They have no idea where they're going. Same with read more. For the link Wikipedia, if someone gets to that, the screen reader will announce, it will say link Wikipedia. So that individual knows when they click that link, they are going to Wikipedia. They're leaving the site and going to Wikipedia. And I can go to almost every website and fail for link descriptions, alt tags, and contrast ratios. Those 3 things I can fail 99%. I think I was bored in my hotel last night. I was on WordPress.org, and I went to their WordPress website showcase. Every single website, there was 9 of them. Every website failed. I just did a quick accessibility audit on the homepage. None of them were 100% compliant, and one of them had like 70 violations on the homepage. And there was quite a few that were missing things like alt tags, link descriptions, contrast ratios, the most simplest things I talk about here. And these are WordPress's website showcase. Come on, we're great. All right, moving on. If we have any questions, please, I'm going to ask questions at the end of this, but don't be afraid to ask as we go. The color of any given content cannot be the only indication of meaning. All right, what's that mean? We got an example one here. This is an incorrect example. This required fields are in red, name and email. Okay, the reason why this is so bad is because when you get to this point, your screen reader is going to announce it like this. Required fields are in red, name and email. Now if you close your eyes and imagine, I told you nothing. Nothing. You don't know which one's required, you don't know which one's red. So just come over here, and the correct example of that is required fields are in red and marked with an asterisk. Name, email, asterisk. And that's exactly how the screen reader is going to announce it. So the individual, if you close your eyes, required fields are in red and marked with an asterisk, name, email, asterisk. Now you know email is the one that is required. Alright, another reason for this. Again, like 90% of men go colorblind. You're talking at least 10% of the world's population is going to be colorblind. So, we've got the incorrect example here. Which is the right angle triangle? You got color triangles here, and then you got the colors here. Well, obviously, if you're colorblind, you will not be able to correlate which one goes with this. So, what you want to do is, which is the right angle triangle? Stick some numbers in there. So now you know which one has the right angle triangle. Right here. Alright. Make sure your font size is at least 16 and is still properly spaced when enlarged by 200%. Now I think the actual recommendation is 15 to 16, but there's some caveats. You can have bold. Some fonts are bigger than others, so you can get away with the 15 if it's a big, if it's a big font. I just say 16 to keep it nice and easy. Another really, really important thing, especially with mobile devices, this is actually what I learned at the National Federation of Blind. When you're watching an individual on the phone, use the internet, they use their phone, they always put their phone up like this. I say always, but they put their phone up right to their eye. And I found out that there's like a magnifying glass, and that's how they navigate the site. So a lot of those people will increase the size of the font. And a lot of plugins nowadays allow users on the front end of your site to do that. We actually have one. You go to stepetedesign.com, stepetedesign.com. In the bottom left-hand corner, there's a plugin by UserWeb. No affiliation with them. It's just an amazing plugin. You can click it. And then a little menu pops up, and they can increase their font size, do all kinds of cool stuff. All right. Error handling. If there's an input error by the user, it must be identified and described in the text, explaining where they went wrong. What's that look like? This right here. I went through this site and just added a couple things, didn't add a couple things in there. And this is how it reacted. I added this red box around here, but everything else is mandatory. You got please review the errors below. Title is required. And then when you're tabbing, you'll end up right on there, so you'll know you're on the title input value. And you'll be able to work your way through. You'll understand where you went wrong. Alright. Tab navigation. Your entire site should be able to be navigated by using only your keyboard. A real important thing I put up here is don't ignore the focus state. I've seen some sites that you can navigate with the tab, but I have no idea where I'm at. Alright, let me go back one here. Let me explain this here. Tab navigation basically is take your mouse, put it in the drawer, navigate your website using only your keyboard, using the tab button, enter, space, up, down. What you want to do is if you go to a website before you hit anything, hit tab. And you should light up here, like your URL. If you hit tab a second time, or as you hit tab, you'll come down and you'll start working your way all the way down in a predictable manner. And you want to make sure that every single thing that you can reach with your mouse, you have to be able to reach and operate by only your keyboard. That's hugely important. That, by itself, is one of the main reasons all these Title III lawsuits have been happening, because an individual user using your site was not able to use some function of the website. So that's huge. And don't ignore the focus state. What that is as you're tabbing through, everything that you're landed on should light up in some way. I like to have a little box, and I make like the button of the element a little bit bigger just to show. show where you are. Because I've seen a lot of sites where you're tab navigating and you have no idea where you are. You're looking down here at the bottom left at your links and just kind of figure out where you are. And that's, you know, they spend so much time in just a simple little thing like your focus state ruins it. All right. You must offer flexible time limits, if any, associated with your website. Now, there's lots of times where you need a time limit. When you're dealing with banks, credit cards, any pertinent information, WordPress security, good practices, or log out idle users. So, you know, there are a lot of times that you need some sort of time limit. So, if you do need a time limit, give the user the ability to gain more time and give it to them very easily. For instance, you're running out of time, maybe a pop-up on your screen pops up and says, you're about to run out of time, click this button for more time. You can give them 5 minutes, 1 minute, 10 minutes, whatever you want. But just make it really easy for that individual to gain more time. Because you gotta remember, when we're looking at these sites, you and I, we can navigate these every page in a matter of seconds. We know right where we wanna go, we see it, we scroll, we're good. A low vision individual does not have that ability. They are on these pages for a long period of time, and there's long periods of time when they're not really interacting with that page. For instance, some people just turn on your screen reader to read. So when you land on a page, the screen reader will just start reading everything. And they could be there 5-10 minutes without hitting another button. So you don't want them to get 3/4 halfway through your site and then it times out, they gotta re-go through that whole process. Alright, number 11, provide skip navigation links so that users can skip repetitive content such as nav menus or widgets. I'm pretty sure we've all we're all developers or designers or have something to do with websites. So when we used to build our websites, we used to love these big, beautiful nav menus up top. Show you everything. The more drop down menus you had, the better your site looked, the more you can charge. So that was fantastic. But what that does now is for an end user who's visually impaired or having a hard time mapping your site, they're going to go there. Every page they visit to on your site, they've got to navigate that huge navigation menu. They've got to get through that whole process every single time they go to another page. And you can imagine how irritating that would be. So I'm going to show you how to fix that. This is Publix. I've not seen any Publixes up here. Down in Florida. That's all there is. What this is you gotta skip the primary content, as simple as that. So when you go to your site, again, you're tab navigating, you're gonna hit tab, your URL should light up, but the second thing that happens when you hit that that tab button is it should light up this right here. This should pop up. And you can skip the primary content. This will skip all of this and come down here or come down here, wherever you want it set to. Now, the cool thing is this is not there for anybody just regularly visiting your site. This only lights up if you tab it. You can have it not do that, but I prefer it like that, just for design reasons. Alright. Most things come with tab navigation these days, but I'm sure we've all got that one customer that just doesn't want an update, doesn't want anything new. In that case, you can simply go to the back end and download this plugin. This is not our plugin. We have nothing to do with this plugin whatsoever. It's just a good plugin. And once you download and activate it, this is the first thing that pops up, enable skip links. And then, like I was saying, you can do skip links are always visible, but I don't bother with that. Is it really not necessary unless it's a disabled user? All right. Well, that is the 11 easy steps. If anybody wants to take a picture, if you didn't on the first time around, this is good picture material right here. It gives you all your 11 steps, nice and easy. Just give everybody a minute. All right. That was easy. Had a nice gift here, but took them out. Okay, here are some free accessibility testing tools. You got AxeChrome. When I'm testing sites and I'm using my IO testers, I start with AxeChrome. You because that's kind of known for the least amount of false positives. So I'll start with that. Then I'll come down to my wave. What that I like to use for, that lays out my header. It's really nice for me to see, to make sure everything is in a predictable order. You know, my site's nice and semantic, and everything's in line the way it needs to be. Okay, then I'll run it through Google Lighthouse. And all these tools are completely free. Everything I offer you here is free. 100% free. Not premium, it's just free. Google Lighthouse. Okay, this is cool for a couple reasons. One, Google Lighthouse gives you an actual number, 1 through 100. Tells you how compliant your site is. Another really cool thing this does for you is it gives you, and I'll go into detail all these in a little bit later. Google Lighthouse gives you a great beginner's manual testing process. I think it'd be 12 steps that you can look and you can check. You can use to check every single site you have with this manual process. It's not everything you need, but it's a great, great starting point. Contrast ratio checker. There's tons of them out there. I just threw this one here because it's my favorite. You go there, you check your contrast ratio. Make sure you're good to go. WordPress accessibility tool. This is our plugin, but it is completely free. We don't even want an email. I mean, it's just free. And what I'm doing basically is as I'm going through this, the whole accessibility world, and I'm coming across problems, I'm taking my solutions and I'm trying to just cobble them together. So everybody, if anybody's a knucklehead like me and needs as much help as possible, you know, that's what I'm trying to do. So in this, I give you a missing alt text finder. That was actually, it's one of the easiest things, adding alt text, one of the easiest things to do as you're building a site, but it's actually one of the harder things to do after you've already built your site. Because we all know, once your picture, your image is in your media library, you push it to the front of your site, you could change it on the front of your site, and it doesn't change it on this page, or it won't change it in your media library. You can add alt text in your media library, and it doesn't push it to the front of your site. That's a pain. So what we did, this tool brings all of your images together that are missing alternative text, and it just allows you to easily add the alt text, hit enter, and it sends it to wherever it got it from. We put the totally testing software from the Cotton University in there. And then we added the contrast ratio checker, and I also went through and added an interactive WCAG 2.1 checklist, which we took the entire WCAG 2.1 guidelines, and I just tried to put it in, like I said, I'm a knucklehead, so I just try to put it in more plain English to try to help people like me understand what it is. God bless you. All right, some more tools. Userway.org, that is the little piece of CSS that I explained to you guys that's on the front of our site that adds allows the end user to do things like increase font size, increase your cursor size, change contrast ratios, desaturate, highlight all your links, all kinds of cool things. So if you don't do anything when you walk out this door, do this. Add this free plugin. I think they ask for your email, but that's it. Add this plugin to the front of your site. You will help a lot of people. Accessibility statement generator from the W3C. This is super important as well. They just asked me, a W3C, that is the top tier for accessibility. They're the ones who built the WCAG guidelines and everything. So that is the go-to source. There's lots of accessibility generators out there from random companies. Just use that. That's coming from the source. And what they'll do is they'll take about 15, 20 minutes. They ask you a bunch of questions about your accessibility, who you are, who to contact. And then when you're done, it spits you out a PDF. And you can take that PDF and link it in your footer. And what this does is this allows an individual who's having trouble with your website, it gives them a process to say, okay, if you're having trouble, contact this person and let them know. So then you're able to rectify that, and in my opinion, so many lawsuits wouldn't even get that far if an individual had an outlet to just contact somebody and say, hey, listen, your site's not accessible. I'm having problems with this. You know, can you help me? Can you fix this? And that gives you the opportunity to talk to them to fix it before it even gets to that point. So that's huge. If there's two things I can get you to do, that would be the second thing. Alright, you got MBDA. This is a screen reader, completely free. And this was actually it's just the best one that's not $500-$600. Chromebox is another free one. It's in the little developer tools, widgets and stuff up there for Chromebox. It's pretty cool. One point, one tip is before you turn on your screen readers, know where the off button is. Trust me, you will panic. Especially if you're giving a demonstration, it's ugly. Okay, here's some resources I give you guys. The actual WCAG 2.1 guidelines from the W3C. Okay, this is the DOJ withdrawing their recommendations. A few years ago, there's this big hoopla. They're going to make it, it was going to be the law for everybody, not just government agencies and contractors, but for everybody. But they pulled back on it. This is the list of lawsuits in the first 2 months of 2018. You should check that out. Hundreds and hundreds of them. Amazon, Nike, Rolex. Huge companies you would think would be compliant. You would think they have an accessibility officer. You would think they have millions of dollars in their budget. These fools were not. So now they're dealing with lawsuits. That's just the first couple months. If you go to this, hundreds in the first couple of months. Comparison table, section 508, just basically a 2.0 and 2.1. The main difference for 2.1 is they added a lot of things for mobility, cursors and navigating for mobile stuff like that. Okay, WordPress accessibility info, they actually give you a lot of great information. Who thunk it, right? I went to a lot of resources before I landed on this. But this down here, this here is the actual law. This is the law that was signed in December of last year. It is law for all government agencies, all nonprofits, anybody doing business with the government, even if you're not taking a dollar, you have to be Section 508 compliant. There's the proof. Okay, do we have any questions thus far? Yes.
Me?
Yes.
Nonprofits, that means all nonprofits as far as 501c3, or?
Yes.
All have to be compliant.
Your question is, do all nonprofits have to be compliant? Yes, they do. I was just, I run the WordPress meetup group for Tampa. I'm from St. Pete, so we're super active in there. And we just, a couple weeks ago, a Tech for Good, all the local WordPress guys went down for this meetup for Tech for Good, and it's just a whole room full of nonprofits, and we help them with their websites. They give us their problems, and we sit down with them, work one-on-one type of thing, and that was a very hot topic. Because I brought that up, and yes, if you Google it, it tells you right there, even if you're not getting funded, because more than likely you have tax breaks, and that's funding, as far as the government's concerned. Yes, sir.
I have a question. One point is, you mentioned that using decorative and the alternative text.
Yes.
I think another solution might be not to use those kinds of images that are decorative in your HTML markup, but to use those images that are decorative in CSS banners, because then you don't need
your screen reader, I understand your point, your screen reader follows the DOM.
But if the image doesn't convey any information, you don't have to have a screen reader read anything.
Correct.
Alright, second point, or second question, or a question. What's the title attribute?
I'm sorry?
The title attribute?
Yes, the title of the document is.
No, not the title at the time. Title attribute.
Over an image? And it's a title text that the tooltip that shows me how to
over
it.
And also hover over it.
You can apply it to any element. It's supposed to use for using links.
So I don't understand the question.
All
text is specifically for and the alt text is in the law.
I'm not talking about the alt. I'm talking about the title attribute that you'll find in, let's say, the link element or image.
Okay. It's mandatory. I mean, it's definitely.
Where does the title show up? Is what I'm saying.
And I'm not talking about the title of the document.
If you're using the tab navigation and you're navigating through your website, for instance, we have videos on our website. So when you get there, you need a title attribute of that announcing that that's a video.
Or when you go to Google Maps, you need an announcing, that's Google Maps, so that individual knows where they are. So when they land on like the YouTube video, as you're hitting tab, you're not on your page anymore. You're tabbing through that little video, you know, your stop, start, CC, things like that. So that I hope I'm answering your question.
Okay, I think you're answering, didn't I?
Yes, sir.
Actually, to respond to the first thing you said about the CSS images, I mean, maybe it's obvious, but it's important not to use CSS to insert images that are important, that contain important information, because
Correct.
You might not see that.
Correct. Yeah, your accessibility tree just doesn't follow that. Yes, sir.
First of all, thank you for putting out all this info. It's the third or fourth conference I see on accessibility, and it's the first time I'm getting all the tools that we need to build for developers. Thank you very much. I really appreciate that. And the second of all, my question was, you said earlier like not to put like links that says read more. What do you do, or what should we say when you have a small excerpt and then you want your client to, or the user to go and see like the full art and like the full post? What do you say instead of read more? What do you do?
Yes, what's a good supplement for instead of a read more or click more? What I like to do is, for instance, on our website, under like about us, I have a little insert about me. And again, instead of read more, it says read more about Joe. And then they'll click that and go to there. Or if you can't really think of it, there's been many times where I've just highlighted a whole sentence. Like, you know, I can't think of anything, but you can highlight that whole sentence and it'll just read. Because the screen reader will announce it's a link and then read whatever that text is. So you can say, you know, follow this to Wikipedia, anything you want to, really.
But what about, like, if you have a blog where it's a post and you've got this automatic read more that you just add in with it after an excerpt? What do you do then? It's built in.
Well, if it's built in, you can come in and add an ARIA label. I mean, you can add certain things to that, and that'll announce to the screen reader of what that is. So when they get to that, it'll say whatever text you want it to say. That's a little bit more of a pain in the butt. But like you said, if you get to that situation where your theme is automatically doing stuff and you don't want to bother going in and changing all that, you know, you can add an ARIA label, things like that. Any more questions? Yes, sir?
Well, it used to be a federal employee that is such a viral way to respect the 1970s. Accessibility Act was back in 1979. You said it was a new law, effective 2019.
Yes.
So what has changed in the Section 508 provision?
Well, I believe it's kind of, you asked two questions here, because you got a difference between WCAG 2.0 and 2.1 that's been updated to deal with mobility, because obviously in the last 5-10 years it's all about iPhones and tablets. Section 508 I'm not really sure what you're asking.
Well, Section 508 goes back a long time.
Correct.
And it sounds like you said there's a new version of Section, or a new law, mm-hmm. that talks about Section 508 and what you have to do to comply with it. So I'm wondering, have things changed?
I don't know what's changed from the old Section 508. I'm not very familiar with that. I honestly didn't think they were different. I just assumed that they were there, but it's law for government agents. Because again, I gave the link. If you go in and it breaks it down, it what it says is you have to be WCAG A and AA compliant. And WCAG has updated, so maybe it has to do with that, because A and AA compliant from 2 years ago was different than what it is now.
I think that's it, because the past mentioned the web accessibility guidelines at all.
Right.
It's a much better approach.
They're pretty much, they go together. You cannot be Section 508 compliant without understanding WCAG guidelines, at least A and AA. Yes, sir.
Just to throw out there, because I have to point to that thing, because I was really curious. There's a completely separate bill called the 21st Century IDEA Act. And IDEA is an acronym because they always are. But it's just a very simple thing that gets right to that. It's web-focused. Federal agencies have to, anytime they do a web thing, they have to respect it. So I guess it's just sort of like making sure it's in law that 508 applies to web
right.
Something. But it's a total seems like I got out of
right.
Order, but yeah.
Yeah, I know that's a problem. I mean, that's why. That's why I went through and changed all, because even the WCAG guidelines are just super technical. Yes, sir.
I'm sure you've heard of the big campus slide of the computer.
Yes, yeah.
I thought the audio was fantastic, but so one thing that was missing for me was kind of part of the preparation with the current editor and other site builder out there. Mm. I was just curious, what's your personal recommendation, or what you've seen with clients using, direct tool for editor versus Gutenberg, and is Gutenberg good or bad for us?
It's been a few years since I've developed the site because I'm primarily focused on accessibility at this point. But from everybody I've talked to, they say Gutenberg has taken a step back. There are some things that it does better, like you're able to mark up image decorative and a few things. But as far as I understand, the developers that I'm dealing with are pretty irritated with it. But I take that with a grain of salt because anytime there's change, people fight back and it angers them. So you kind of have to just wait and see. As far as I'm not seeing any more sites as far as Gutenberg or even WordPress compared to other CMSs for accessibility, I will say WordPress is the easiest for me to remediate. I've done things on Squarespace and all kinds of weird sites, and it's Wix. It becomes a lot more difficult. So. Yes, ma'am.
Two things. One is talking about CSS and not putting point images in CSS. Are background images, like the use all over the place and slide or whatever, hero images, those are in CSS, right? So is there some way to make them involved with the screen reader? And two, is there a plugin to add these ARIA labels? Because I didn't know what that was until
you. I don't know of any plugins to add ARIA labels. If you want, I can give you a card. I have a ton more resources. I only have so much time. I can definitely email you. I got a few articles that describe very clearly, very easily how to use ARIA labels. One thing I want to say about ARIA labels is that bad ARIA labels are worse than no ARIA labels. So if you don't know what you're doing with ARIA labels, just leave them, because a bad ARIA label will send them way off. So and as far as if you're using it for decorative or not using it for decorative, you can label them. Decorative, or again, stick some sort of ARIA label or something on there. If it's not, if you get to the front end when you're testing your site and you're seeing it, and it is important, it is conveying information, and it's not, you can go add something to it to bring it up. Again, I'm not a developer. I'm sorry.
No worries.
You have any other questions before we move on to the next part? Yes, ma'am. You want to use an alt tag, you probably could, and it might announce it if you do it right, but I always say alt tag because the actual guidelines say alt tag. And I get a lot of questions too. People are like, well, can I, because people like to use a description or title tag for SEO, things like that, and they ask if that's good enough, and it's just alt tags. Yes, sir.
Just to follow on that, to clarify, this may be getting in the weeds, but if you have a div that has a background, does alt text work on a div element, or is alt text only for image elements?
I'm not really 100% sure, to be honest with you. Yes, sir.
To answer that, no. The alt attribute.
Well, I'm sorry, was that no?
No.
Okay.
The alt attribute provides an image element and only an image element with an accessible name. If you are using a div to create a background image, you can use ARIA labels to provide an accessible name. However, it has some issues around translation. So, if at all possible, promote images to image content if it has a meaningful kind of point to the document. Otherwise, CSS background image is totally fine. The other kind of end of that, the title attribute, not the title element, which provides a document title, the title should only be used for embeds such as iframe content and provides an accessible name. So YouTube video of what, or this contains a form for this. There's actually a WCAG violation criteria for using the title attribute for anything other than these things. There's significant interoperability problems, which
I just follow up on your question and your answer to ask? Was title a regarded an attribute to those? Was description replaced by title that you know of? I remember description used to be grammar routine.
The
W3 was mentioning that either title was replacing description or something to that effect. And I believe the language was replacing which.
When you put accessibility, you definitely want your alt tag. That's the most important. I always say.
I'm not referring to this div question.
Oh, okay. I got you.
I'm following up on the previous two comments. So, sorry.
Oh, no, did you get your question answered? I don't know.
Not yet. I just don't remember which was which, but I think one was being replaced by the other in W3, description versus title, in this context.
Okay. Thank you. All right. Well, I don't think we have any more questions.
Question?
Question to Matt?
Yes. Question. So, is there a grace period for non-compliance? There is not. Okay.
Not that I know of.
Okay.
There was a big thing, like if you get sued, they would say, by the time we got to courts or whatever, the website would actually start to build, to fix their accessibility issues. So there were a few cases that the judge said that the lawsuit was moot.
Okay.
M-O-O-T. I'm not really sure how to pronounce that, but I guess that, you know, that's just saying that the point is useless at this point because they fixed it. But then, I read that probably about 6-8 months ago. Then a couple of months ago, I read that another case got thrown out because they tried using the moot point, saying, "Well, they gave us the paperwork saying we're getting sued or whatever, and then we fixed our website, so this is irrelevant now." And the judge threw it out. Basically, the problem is there's no concrete guidelines to what's going on here, and they're just letting the judge regulate. They're letting the judges regulate. So every decision that comes down changes the trajectory of the accessibility lawsuits. So as of now, I don't believe that there's a grace period, but there has been cases where there was, in a sense.
And then, so part two, I guess, then, is there an enforcement mechanism outside of getting a lawsuit, or beyond that?
Not necessarily. I learned when I went to WordCamp Orange County that over there, I own a restaurant in St. Pete. I've owned one for 12 years. So I've dealt with, so I think I'm a little bit uniquely qualified. I've dealt with ADA on the brick and mortar side. And what happened is, in California, anyways, if you have a brick and mortar, you're not accessible, you get instantly fined $4,000. You're getting sued, and you just get a $4,000 fine. Now what they're doing is you get another $4,000 fine for your website. So if your brick and mortar isn't accessible and your website is inaccessible, now you're looking at an $8,000 fine before anything starts, before your lawsuit goes in, before you get lawyered up or anything. So in a way, that's almost like a secondary thing, because beside the lawsuit, besides having to remediate and having to, I've seen million-dollar lawsuits. Before any of that happens, just right out of the gate, you're getting hit with an $8,000 lawsuit, which is already more money than you would have spent on remediating your website.
Okay, thank you.
I hope that answered your question.
Yes.
Do you have any other questions?
Yes, sir. I have one question about the audio descriptions for videos.
Uh-huh.
Are there, like, tools or plugins that can be added kind of second, or like third-party tools or plugins that can be added to include the audio descriptions, or is it like if we have a video that doesn't have audio descriptions, you just have to add voiceover to it?
All right, so the question is there third-party plugins that do your audio descriptions for you? Yes. I'm sorry. I've not seen a plugin do that, but I've seen third-party, like Amazon does it. Amazon does it pretty cheap as well. I think I used it one time, it was like 99 cents or $1.99, and it was like a 10-minute video. That was pretty good. But other than that, that's really about it. All right. What we're going to do here is I'm going to move on to the second part of this, and we're going to talk a little bit about how to audit your site.
is go all this, go all this. How to easily audit your website for accessibility issues. Alright, here's some more facts for you. People with disability combine for over $2 trillion in income. It's a lot of money, that's a lot of customers people are leaving out there because they think accessibility is willy-nilly. Okay, and friends and families of those individuals account for $8 trillion. That's a lot of money. And think this way too. If your site's accessible, you're probably top 10% on the internet. So more than likely, if a customer's looking for what you're selling, and they're disabled of some sort, they're more than likely going to find you and use your site. Okay, over 1.3 billion have some sort of disability. Together, we can make a difference. I can't stress this enough. WordPress is the largest CMS in the world by far. I think the closest one is like 8% or something. It's ridiculous. So if anybody's going to make a difference, it's the people in this room. Us. Okay, these are steps to audit your site. Now again, we're just doing basic stuff here. This is not our full process. Use a code validator to make sure your code is good. Here's a simple one right here, W3C. Again, I'm going straight to the horse's mouth. You can find most of your problems doing that. But what I do is I have our developers don't even send me the site unless you've done your validation, unless your code's validated. Don't even bother with it. Once they ship that to me, I'll go through and I'll use all my automated testing tools, which I'm going to go through in a little bit more detail. I'm going to show you how to actually use them. I mentioned them earlier, but I'm going to show you how to use them here. And then after that, we go through and we manually test the site. A little tip is, like I said, throw your mouse in the drawer. Forget about it. Forget even all of them. Don't forget to test your site on your Android and iOS or whatever mobile device you have. That's hugely important. Whenever possible, ask a friend. If you have a low vision individual or a disabled friend, ask a friend. Through WordCamps and that National Federation of the Blind, I've met so many people. And we actually have people that will, after we go through and test our sites, we'll ship it over to them. They just have a simple little checklist on navigating the site. And they just tell us where their problems are. And that's just a good way for them to make a little bit of extra income. But you'll find so many mistakes. I'll swear the site is 100% accessible, and they'll find three or four things that just makes me feel stupid. All right, free automated testing tools. We're going to start with the Axe tool, since it's my favorite. You can get it from the deck right there, that's the link. Very simple. It works for Chrome, Firefox, Android, and it's known for false positives. What you want to do is you're going to go there and you're going to download it, and it'll add it to, I use Chrome, and it'll add it up to your extensions. So, but it'll put a little icon in your extension, but that's not where you use it, I'll show you. Okay, where you use it is you go to your site. We're going to pick on WordPress.org a little bit. Again, I use Windows, so I right-click, pulls up, and I inspect. I right-click and hit inspect, and it pulls up this here, however you got to get to here, this is how you get there. Come up here, you hit these, and then this menu drops down, and this is where Axe puts Axe. So you can see right here, this is Axe as well, and it adds it up there, but you don't, it's useless. I don't know why they put that there. You gotta do this. So, once you do that, get that far, this is what pops up. One button, analyze. And this is what happens. Okay, there's 6 violations on WordPress.org. They're all color contrast issues, saying that it doesn't meet minimum requirements. And then what you do is right here, is actually it comes standard where you have to click it. It says highlights. You click that highlight, and then you see this is it highlighting your issue, telling you where your problem is. You see that's 2 of 6. And what you can do is as it's highlighting, just hit that forward or back button, and this little box will work its way up all the way down. It's really cool. It tells you where your source is, and also too, it tells you what your color contrast is, and in some issues, it'll give you a suggestion of what color to use that'll bring you into compliance. Very, very useful. Okay, you can also click up here where it says violations found. That's that's just, it only tells you the violation. It doesn't tell you good practices and all that stuff. You have to do that, and you have to open this up and look for yourself. So, of the 11 issues, 6 of them were violations. 2 of them, they say you need to look at, double check. 3 of them are bad practices, which, the, you know, 5 out of the 11 aren't going to get you sued. They're not going to make you fail Section 508 compliant, but you're leaving meat on the table to, you know, easy steps that you can take to help the end user. And again, that's what all this is about. I know I talk about lawsuits and trillions of dollars worth of money spent, but I only bring up those points because I'm trying to speak everybody's language. Everybody leaves here and says, nah, I don't need accessibility. I want to hit it where it matters to everybody. And also, too, those are good points. I found in the very beginning of this, when I talk to my clients about accessibility, they look at me like I'm an auto mechanic and just ripping them off. They just think I'm taking them to the house. And I use those points to kind of explain to them why they'll get, you know, why it's valuable for them. Okay, moving on. Google Lighthouse tool. Here's your link. Again, I know I mentioned a couple of these already. Gives you a score of 1 to 100. You know, anything under, I think, 85 or 75, it's like red, or it goes from red, orange to green. And clients like to see that. So once I finish up the accessibility, my audit and remediation, I'll run a couple of these tests just for visual to get that 100. But there's a site out there. I think it's the most inaccessible site by Google Lighthouse. There is a site out there. You can Google it. That it scores a 100 on Google Lighthouse, and it is so inaccessible. So that's one caveat with these automated tools. They don't tell you everything. They don't even tell you most of everything. So you can run 10 automated tools, and you have to run your manual test. Have to. If you didn't run your manual test, don't bother. Okay, and then Google Lighthouse, they offer you the 11-step process, which is fantastic. I'm going to show you that here. Okay, Google Lighthouse, again, you're just going to right-click and inspect. You're going to follow the same steps we did for Axe, except if you remember Axe, they had Axe like right down here. But for this one, we're just going to do audit. So you're going to click that, and this is what's going to pop up. You're going to uncheck everything except for accessibility. You cannot uncheck. You got to have one of these checked, but I always run this twice. I'll run my test on mobile, then I'll run my test on desktop. I run on mobile first because you tend to catch more stuff on mobile. And then when I run desktop, the same things pop up, you know, I just go move on from it. So performance progression. So you want only accessibility check. You don't want to check for all of these. And then I usually don't do throttling. I'm just not worried about that. Okay. And then you just hit run off. I mean, that's it. And then it comes up, pops up. Okay, same website. Again, background colors. I mean, it's, you know, it is what it's, oh, this is .com. Oh, but again, you see up here, 94. We've only got a few things missing here. That says there's only one thing messed up, but it could be multiple color contrast issues. But again, you get the 94, and then that's pretty much about it for that one. But what I do like is this right here. Whenever you do an audit with Google Lighthouse, every website gives you the exact same 12 manual check items. So you can just follow these right here and manually check your website. You'll catch the majority of issues with this right here. Again, it doesn't cover all of it, but you're well on your way. And don't let 12 steps scare you. 5 or 6 of them are pretty much exactly the same. With one swipe through of the page with me tab navigating, I can figure out 5 or 6 of these at a time. Logical tab order, make sure it's left to right, up to down, you know. Interactive controller, keyboard focusable. Make sure every single thing, all of this, everything is keyboard focusable. Interactive elements indicate their purpose and say, so when you land on something, then the screen can read or announce what it was. So as you see, you go down and just one swipe through, you can, and as you learn, as you do this multiple times, it gets easier and easier. So don't let all the 12 steps scare you. It's actually very, very easy. All right, here's another tool, the Wave Evaluation Tool. There's a couple of ways you can do this. You can go to their website, and then you can just copy-paste your URL, and then you can do it. Or you can download it as a Chrome extension, which is what I do. Then any site you're on, you just hit the little button and it just automatically does it. And this is great. I use this mainly for checking my header levels. It does a real good job for lighting up my headers. Okay, so here it is. This is what the button looks like when you add it up there. And again, you just go to the site, tap the button. Or you can go to their site, webaim.org, and then just copy paste your URL there. However, it doesn't matter. It's exactly the same. This is what it looks like. It pops up a menu on the left-hand side. It tells you a lot of different stuff here. Now this plugin, they all are good at that. This plugin is good, but it's bad because it gives you you don't need 90% of this stuff here. So we're just going to look at our errors. So the errors basically is this button right here. You'll just click this button to come down to your errors. Now another cool tip here is filter. Right now I'm running full. This means it's running all compliance issues against everything it knows. Section 508, WCAG, everything. So what you want to do is, I think I did it on this next one, yeah, I put Section 508 in there. So you put Section 508, you click that and the drop-down menu comes down and gives you options, what you want to test it against. I choose Section 508 because this is where we're at, it's America, that's what everybody wants. So this gives you what it is. Alright, what we're going to do here is, what it does, if you see H1, you see how it lights up my headers, which is really, really good. That's very useful for me to go through and check this out. Now it's giving you an alert. It's a skipped header, H1, H3, it's skipping. Now in my opinion, you shouldn't do that. It should be H1, H2, H3, H4, just work your way down. But, you can do that if... You can see, for instance, here, like, that's just a skip header, that's a nuisance, that's not a fail. What a lot of people think of fail is you go from H3 to H2, because when people are using screen readers, they're navigating by their headers, so you can imagine someone's going to hit tab, they're going to go down here, or they're going to hit H1, then they're going to go to H2, then they're going to go back up to H3, blah, blah, blah. That's not a predictable order, but there is a caveat to where if... We'll use this scenario. If your H3 is closing information, and then H2 is opening the next group or text, then you're okay. But that's pretty much about it. And again, I use this to show me the header, because you can just scroll down. You can just very easily see. I can just visually. Say, okay, H1, H3, we got a problem there, but that's not a fail. H3, H2, okay, that's a problem. Now I gotta look to say, is that closing content? Yes, that's closing content. H2, is that opening content? Yes, that's opening content. Okay, that's accessible. Yes, sir.
Just a real quick question. Does Wave work like after you've logged in if you have some private?
No. Okay. You can, anybody can put any website in there.
Okay.
So I said tonight I'll just go through WordPress like I did last night, WordPress.org. Just testing stuff.
Oh, I'm sorry, I mean the sort of the opposite. Like if I do want to test a private part of my WordPress site, there's snapshot the HTML.
Yeah, no, if it's a private, like members only or something like that, no, you gotta already log in.
Okay.
And then what I'll do is I'll go to the back of my site and put a few changes or whatever. I'll go to that page and then run my but you gotta be careful with that, because when you're at that stage, you're in your development stage. Let's say we're on this page or on the back end, but we're viewing it from the front. You're gonna have your WordPress line up here with all your stuff. Well, this software can call all that out as well. So just understand that a lot of that isn't there when you're on the front. Somebody else is on the front. Otherwise, you'll be there all day. Okay. Let's see. Accessibility auto totally. This is very useful. This is from the Cotton University, and I found this to be one of the most useful tools besides Axe for me, so this is the one that we included in our plugin. So, like, download our plugin, you can get it here, or you can go to this right here, which is the Cotton University, and you get it from there. If you do it from there, there's actually other plugins that have that totally software as well. So, this was actually done before we integrated in our plugin. So, one of the which plugin we use, but when you do it's and you can see that they use it totally, and they put the wave side. So we go here, we go there, preview changes. Here we go. And then what it does is, you can't see here, we go back one. Okay, what it does here is when you start it, it adds this little icon down here in the bottom left hand corner, right here, glasses. And then when you get to your page that you want to check, you just click that button that was down here and this menu pops up. Now this menu, I like this, because this gives you a lot right here, and it does inundate you with information like Wave does. Just Wave throws everything at you. This lets you check one at a time. Okay, I'm going to check my headers. So you're going to come up here, you're going to click headers, and then what happens is this box pops up. And right now, my mouse is scrolling over this. You can't see it, but it's scrolling over this. And that's why this is lit up. Because it's telling me that this is where this failure is. This document contains an H4, so it's saying, hey, you got an H4 way up here. But again, I mean, this is part of development, because there's no way, and someone had a question earlier, this is in the theme. There, you know, I'm going to go in and manually change this, which I need to do. But it gives you the relevant code, and also you can, it'll give you suggestions, which I think will come up next in your contract. Yeah, it'll give you suggestions. Okay, you go to the contract, then done with your headings. Okay, we're going to move on to our contrast ratio. Again, I'm going to highlight up insufficient contrast ratio. I'm highlighting with my mouse, and this is what pops up. You know, it highlights it for me. It's telling me that my color's not good. I think it's something 4.0. It needs to be 4.5. So what it does too is it also gives me a recommendation. It says, hey, use this, and it'll bring it to 4.51, like a 10 over. Yes.
Was this? I just wanted, if you could, before we move to the next one, provide that URL again for us real quick. But was this a plugin? Is this accessible only to the plugin that we see?
This is a plugin that I'm using right now, and there's multiple ways to get it. Again, the Khan University is the one who designed and developed it, and multiple people have used it. Let me go back here. That's the short code. I'm not here to talk about myself. I'm not here to talk about my stuff, but if you go to the WordPress repository and you type in WordPress accessibility tool, that's our plugin, and inside that plugin, we make it really, there's this little row of tabs. One of them is accessibility testing. All you gotta do is go there and click on. And then you go to your page and you'll have all of that. There are other plugins too. I was trying to see which one it is here. Oh, Wallet. Okay, well, this is the other one. So you can probably go into the WordPress repository and type in Wally testing tool, and that'll probably pop up. I would prefer just to give the link to our plugin, but then I feel dirty. It makes me feel dirty. All right, link text. Again, you just come over here, you can highlight over it, and it points up here. This is just a phone number. It's saying that's not descriptive enough. So we did change this. So now in here, it says up here, I forget exactly the terminology, but it's like to contact us, call the number, and the whole thing's a link now. Same thing. Okay. The other image alt tags and landmarks and stuff, we're going to scroll down here. This I think is pretty cool. A screen reader wand. What this does is whatever you're scrolling over, right now my mouse is scrolling over this, and this is telling me what the screen reader will read. This is telling me. It doesn't say whether it's an alt tag or aria or whatever it is. That's saying that's how the screen reader will now. So if a person taps onto this picture, the screen reader will read Section 508 compliance consultant's logo. Now I left this up because there is a mistake in this. If you ever have words in your image, you want your words to be described as well. Any words or numbers in a logo or an image, you want in your alt tag. And I've had questions where what happens if you just have so much information, things you do, you can add tables, you know, as your URL labels and stuff. But that is, it's really just another way to check with your screen. All right, manually auditing your website.
basic stuff that I think everybody can accomplish here. Unplug your mouse and navigate your website only using your keyboard. That is one that every single person here can do. Take your mouse, like I said, throw it in your drawer, just spend an hour navigating your site. If you want to go out back and jump off a bridge, you probably got work to do. Let's see, use the tab key, arrows key, and enter to check a few things, like making sure you can reach every function on your site. Make sure your tab order and all is in predictable manner and stuff. Okay, number two, make sure everything can be read by assistive technology, like screen readers. There's a couple ways you can do this. Download the NVDA or Chromebox or whatever screen reader you want. I mean, I think JAWS, they got JAWS, which is amazing. I've never used it because it's like $600. Or you can use that alley testing software like I was just showing you, where you're mousing over things and it tells you what the screen reader will announce. Alright, there's some other things you can do. These are things you want to check. And again, a lot of these are on that Google Lighthouse I was talking to you guys about that comes standard. Okay, you got to make sure your page has a logical tab order and the focus state is apparent as you're tabbing through. Make sure it's left to right, up to down, in the logical order, not down, up, all over the place. And make sure wherever you're landed on, you have a focus state. Like I said, I like to use two. When you land on it, a little box will pop up, and sometimes it'll get bigger. If it's not something that's appearing at, you know, if it's something that's already there and I'm tabbing, you'll get a box and get bigger. Okay, headings, don't skip levels, H1s above H2s, above H3, etc. Explain that, you know, there are times where you can come back, but typically, like the first one I showed, you don't want an H1 to an H3. Make that H3 an H2, or make the H1 an H2. Make it in logical order. Try not to skip. You know, and I got my start with making websites, and I'm not going to lie, I used to cheat and use headers instead of a bold text or instead of making text bigger. I just used a header here and there before I realized, you know, how selfish that was. Make sure all your custom controls have ARIA roles and labels, you know, just simple stuff. All your interactive elements show their purpose or announce their purpose. Again, we're talking about videos. I have videos or Google Maps. There's third-party plugins that people, you know, everybody's got a Google Map on their site these days. Everybody's got a contact form. So when that person gets to that, make sure the screen reader announces, this is a contact form, this is Google Maps, whatever it is, let them know. Off-screen content, make sure your off-screen content is hidden from assistive technology. This mostly has to do with mobile devices, phones and stuff. Obviously, when your size shrinks, some columns or something can go off-site. So as you're tab navigating, if they're not cut off, I've seen this happen a few times. You're tab navigating, you're in this column over here, like this is your site, but your focus is in a column over here, not on your site. So as an individual, you don't know where your focus data is. You have no idea, you're lost. So make sure anything that's off-site is not reachable. Really, just make sure you're building your site in WordPress so it's responsive and everything works. All forms work properly. Have error handling when necessary. Again, we've gone through this. Just make sure when you hit a contact form or something, go on that and enter some information like I did and see and screw it up and see what feedback that site gives you, if it does actually tell you. Visually check for contrast ratios, especially text on top of images. That's one thing that the automated testing tools cannot do. So when you have an image, we all like to have a nice hero image or a background image, and then you have text over that. Now, I've seen situations where you have a text of a guy in the business suit in the background, extended his arm, and he's got the white long-sleeve shirt underneath his suit, but then you got text. You got white text over that. So 90% of the text is proper contrast ratio, but you got four or five letters that are just absolutely unreadable. And that'll change as you make your screen larger and smaller. So just be aware of things like that. And you can, that's easy stuff to do. Again, when you're just manually checking, you're running through, that stuff, you see 12, 15 step process to manually check, but most of these things can be found on one or two runs of the page. Okay, we got testing for iOS. Let's see here. The best thing you can do for iOS and for Android is to use your automated test, or I'm sorry, not your automated, is at the bottom here.
use your accessibility, here it is, use the built-in features of your iOS device and of your Android device. Every single one of them has it. You go to your settings and hit accessibility. There'll be an accessibility tab right there. You hit it, and you'll have all kinds of stuff. I think voice to text and a couple other things that are real important ones that you'll test. Use those first, because they're standard, they're free, they're right there. Everybody has them. And it's what an end user is going to be using. When they, if they're on their phone, that's where they go. That's what you want to do. Okay, you can use your automated testing tools. For iOS, utilize Mac Xcode simulation. And I put a link there. I've never used it, but my Android or my app testing team, they live and die by this for iOS. Okay. You can also test the iOS accessibility testing for VoiceOver. This just allows you, these are just simple steps you can do. Use the built-in feature, other accessibility info for the iOS. You go there and they give you, this article gives you a lot of good info for that. Alright, testing for Android. Same thing, the very first thing you want to do is use the built-in features of Android. Just do it. Okay, then you go through, use your automated testing tools. Then Android has an accessibility scanner simulation, which is pretty cool. You go to the Play Store and you download this. It's completely free. And then you can open up an app on your phone, and this will test that. This will test that accessibility. It's absolutely really cool. And I'm surprised, because usually iOS is on the forefront of stuff like this, but Android's not. Use the UI automated viewer, and you get that here as well. All right, I guess that's about it for this. Do we have any questions? I know I haven't bored to death yet. I appreciate you guys staying. Yes, sir.
I was asked, I'm questioning about the H1. There's always been this debate having just one H1, and some other people say you could put H1 into an article tag, and that'll be okay. And I was just wondering how that can be read by screen readers. It's just better like just to have one H1 and then like having an H2 for your title of an article.
I personally prefer to use my H1 and then just the front on the top, and then everything else is like H2. Basically my H1s become my H2s, H2s and H3s. You can use H1s anywhere you want, again, as long as it's a predictive manner. Predictable, manner. But what you can do is, like I explained, just checking the time here, 20. Okay. So what you can do is, like I said, you can have H1 and then you have your body content and come down and have another H1, but they have to be your H1. If you have an H1, let's say you have an H1, H2, and then an H1 again. That's acceptable only if that H2 is closing the previous content and the H1 is opening the new content. But, like I said, for usability, my own personal best practice, is I like the H1 header. The only time I use that is the initial one. Everything else, every other main title, I try to use H2s.
Okay.
So. I work for UMass Boston, so we're very heavily invested with AD compliance, and we've had consistent issues over thousands of pages with that, and we found the only way to get that was to get the main templates to read the page titles as H1 only. It seems to be the safest.
The safest one. Yeah. Okay. Thank you.
I didn't hear the last part.
That it should be the page title.
H1, yes, yeah.
Yeah.
Good practice.
The page
title,
right.
Because you're right, it alleviates all that issues and hassle.
I didn't know what you meant when you said to close the H2. I mean, the tag itself is closed as H2, so I wasn't sure what you meant with the other scenario.
I'm trying to.
Well,
basically, as you're doing your website and you have content, we'll just get to something like this right here. This is your H1, and then you have H3, but that H3 is closing this content right here. So the next one down here, do I have it? H2 right here. That's opening the next content. So that's the only time you're allowed to have where that's not in predictable order. That's not, because H1, H3, H2. Someone will look at that and be like, wait a minute, that's a fail.
But it's not technically a fail because H3s are closing previous content and then H2 is opening the next content.
Of different sections, right?
Of different sections, yes. Yes, ma'am.
I missed the I missed the beginning. Was ADA compliancy an issue? Is it like U.S. Regulation? Did you discuss that already?
Section 508 is strictly American law.
Okay.
And the WCAG 2.1 are guidelines over in Europe. It's the law for everybody. So they're on fire over there. But Section 508 is the American version of WCAG. They say you've got to be WCAG A and AA compliant to be Section 508.
Thank you.
Yes, sir.
Do you have any good themes that are already set up well for accessibility?
Yes. WordPress actually offers accessible ready themes. We build a couple of them, but they do offer it. If anybody, theme builders or anything here, I highly recommend you build your themes to be accessible ready because you get your own category. So when individuals are up looking for themes that are accessible, there's not much. It's relative compared to all the themes out there for WordPress. Your theme is already towards the top. You know, I know developers that when they build sites, they have four or five themes that they choose from, that they've built, that are accessible already. So those are the only themes they give to their potential clients to choose from. So, I hope that answers your question. Yes, yes, ma'am.
Are there any best practices when it comes to using SVGs, or is the best practice to not use SVG?
I'm not really sure, to be honest, which I don't have a lot of experience with that. Sorry. Does anybody here? Anybody here answer that?
Yeah.
Yes?
Scott O'Hara is a really good post on it.
What was that?
Scott O'Hara is a developer for the bunch of other groups.
Okay.
If you're using inline SVG, ironically use the title tag. SVG is parsed slightly differently so that where you use an alt attribute in an image, if it's inline SVG markup, use the title element to provide the equivalent accessible name. If you are embedding SVG using the image element, you use an alt attribute.
Okay. Cool. This is why I love the WordPress community. I learned so much from you guys as well. I mean, really, I really do. Because I have not seen every situation. There's still so much. And I try to watch presentations and videos, and like someone explained earlier, they don't really give you specific info. They just start talking. And I always feel like I didn't learn jack from them. So I appreciate that. Do we have any more questions?
Just to recommend that we use SiteImprove was an accessible checker that we used really well. I found the W3 like overwhelming and just infuriating, and it was just the worst thing to use. And even Wave for me, I found it very difficult. But SiteImprove, SiteImprove is a company, but they have a checker for some of the browsers. So
yeah, I know
that works real well.
Right. I just want to say this. There are tons of accessibility checkers out there. But look real close, I don't know anything about the one you mentioned, but a lot of my seat have been updated in years. Years. Which obviously isn't gonna work. Okay, there's lots of options. And you don't have to pay for anything. So there are lots of paid ones, but you know, a lot of them, they don't do anything different than these free ones I've shown. So I think we're about running out of time. Do we have any last minute questions? No? Okay, well, I just want to leave you with this thought, guys. Again, it is not up to WordPress and Matt Mullenweg to make the internet accessible. It's up to us, everybody in this room, one website at a time, and we will make a dent in this problem. So I appreciate everybody coming out and spending their time, their wonderful Sunday afternoon, listening to